You don't have to say, wait on me. I'm waiting for you. John 19 and 29. John 19, chapter, beginning of the 29th verse. It reads, now, there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled the sponge with vinegar, put it to hyssop, and put it to his mouth. Jesus, therefore, had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. He bowed his head and gave up the ghost. For the time of desire to share, you would grab a neighbor next to you. You didn't want to talk to him, you should have sat by and say, neighbor, with your help and your prayer.
And your prayer.
Just gonna preach about
it. Just gonna preach about
it. A victorious victim. Find somebody else real good. Let's look at their hand and say, neighbor, with your help
and
your prayer.
And your prayer.
Just gonna preach about it.
Preach about
a victorious
victim.
You may be seated. Presence of my God. The words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Lord, help me preach.
Victorious victim. Right?
Victorious victim.
Y'all, my favorite television show of all time has to be the thrilling Thursday hit called Scandal, starring Kerry Washington playing Olivia Pope. I'm captivated by this show, y'all, so much that it doesn't matter what I'm doing on Thursday unless I'm at work around 9 o'clock. I got to be at home. If I'm out, I've got to be somewhere where ABC can be seen. The premise behind the show, y'all, is that Olivia Pope, who is this Washington, D.C. attorney and a White House aide, fixes the problems of those victims of scandalous situations. Wouldn't the world be a much easier place if we all had Olivia Pope? Wouldn't the world be much easier if we all had an Olivia Pope to clean up our mess and our prayers? As we approach this text, it would appear that Olivia Pope needs to be called in. Because this whole conspiracy called the crucifixion was a scandal. And the victim was Jesus. Scandal against y'all in John chapter 12. After Jesus resurrected Lazarus from the dead, the chief priests began to consult on how they put Jesus to death. And Lazarus also, due to the fact of his testimony, which was causing others to believe in Jesus. Can I first pause long enough to tell you that having a title is cool, but having a testimony is dangerous. Because everybody ain't happy about what God has done in your life. And some people want to stop others from being encouraged by what God has done for you. That's why when you come in worship, you see those folks that sit there when worship is going on with their hands crossed. They are infringing upon your worship. And the enemy knows that your testimony will help others to know that what they're going through isn't that bad. I wish I had about 5 witnesses in here, and I would have 6 with attention about you to tell somebody that what you've been through. I know somebody who's able to pull you out. Is there anybody up in here besides me who's ever had and needed the Lord to pull you out of some situation, to pull you out of some bad? You
have
a love. Yes, sir. Scandal continues, y'all. When one of the disciples, by the name of Judas, betrays him. How scandalous it is to be betrayed by the one you befriended.
terms of endearment to baby, boo, boo, honey, and sweetie, and pie. It's something when the one that's close to you betrays, baby, I'm by myself.
He continues to be a victim of a scandalous scenario when he's brought before the Sanhedrin Council and handed over to Pilate and the Roman courts and struck charges for press. Trump charges were pressed and he was tried in court like a criminal.
All right.
Notice this, that now Jesus is the victim of a Roman cross, of a Roman court. And as he's hanging on the cross, he utters this sixth saying and says, it's finished. There are some liberals who tried to say that this cry was a cry of defeat. Well, I beg to differ.
No.
Because these three words were not a cry of defeat, but rather a cry of victory.
Yes.
Jesus is teaching us a valuable lesson, y'all, in this sixth saying. He's teaching us a valuable lesson that it's possible to be a victim and still have the victory. You missed it, I'll say it again. Jesus is teaching us today in this sixth saying that it's possible for us to be a victim but still have the victory. Victory does not come from what's around you, but victory comes from what's in you. Everything around you may look like defeat, but victory comes from what's in you. Everything around you may say poor, but victory comes from what's in you. And I get the pages of the Holy Spirit saying, greater is he.
I wish I had some help in here. That lives in me than he that is.
Your victory is not determined by your current condition, but it's determined before the condition commits. In other words, don't judge me by my Friday. Because plans have already been made for my Sunday. Can I say it again? Don't judge me by what you're looking at right now. But there's something greater in store. I wish I had about 5 or 6, and I'll make sure I wouldn't tell and turn your way. But don't judge me by what you see right now. Because what you see right now is just a glimpse of what God is about to do. Right now, may look at it, and give me a few more months, a few more years, and what you'll see, I'll be better than what I am right now. I'll look better, I'll walk better. Is there anybody up in here besides me who can say what you see right now is just an example of what God is getting ready to do?
Your dilemmas, he's in control of your drama, your difficulty, your decisions.
your dealings, your and your dying situation.
I don't know what I'm preaching to this morning, but there's somebody in here that's maybe going through some things that have you troubled, have you stressing out, but God's word for you this morning is chill out. He's got it all under control. He's got it all. He's got your marriage under control. He's got your children under control. He's got your finances under control. He's got your health under control. He's got your schooling under control. He's got your future under control. You want to have out your neighbor and tell him, chill out, chill out, chill out, chill out, chill out. God's got it under control.
Have anything this time. you. They ain't pulling on you. But Jesus, we had a debt, y'all, that we could not afford to pay. Because sin did not bring dollars, but it brought debt. Bible says that the wages of sin is death. But because Jesus paid our debt in full, instead of getting the reward for our sin, we get a gift instead. What is the gift? Thank you, man. The gift of God is eternal life. We had a debt that we could not pay, and so how did he pay the debt? He paid it with his blood. His blood was the propitiation for our sin. So when sin, instead of the Father seeing our pain, he sees his blood. Instead of seeing our mess up, he sees his blood. His blood gives us another chance. You ought to be glad that his blood covers you. That if dollars just wrote something like this, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Is there anybody up here besides me who can give God thank you that he covers you with his blood? God doesn't see your mess up because you're covered by the blood. That's why you can go through what you go through. It's because you're covered by the blood. I'll give about 25 of y'all, and I'll make 26.
Speak not only one.
something to say. Here's the revelation. Jesus is showing us that he's able to take what your enemies use to be bitter and make you better. God's word today is your don't let the vinegar to make you vicious, but rather let it fulfill you and fuel you to keep you talking. Now be somebody in here who can testify that we serve God who will turn things around. They brought you problems, but he gave you some peace. They brought you burdens, but he gave you some blessings. They brought you trouble, but he gave you a testimony. They brought you affliction, but he gave you advancement. When you have to push your neighbor and tell him, let it fuel you. Whatever your enemy brings you, you ought to be able to let it fuel you. Whatever your enemy brings you, you ought to be able to let it fuel you. And don't let the enemy stop you, because God is able to use what they tried to hurt you with in order to help you and to make you better. God is able to use what they used to take you out and mean it for your good. I guess that's why Paul says that what faith meant for evil, the Lord turned it around and meant it for my good. If anybody here this morning who can testify that what your enemies meant for evil, what your enemies tried to take you out, when your enemies dug ditches for you, when your enemies stabbed you in the back, when your enemies threw rocks in hot their hands, God took that situation and turned it around, and he used it for your good. There ought to be about 10 of y'all, and I'll make 11 who can testify that God uses my enemies to make me better. God uses my enemies to make me stronger. God uses my enemies to make me wise. Is there anybody here that's glad that the Lord uses your enemies in order to bless you? The Bible says that he'll make your enemies be your footstool. Have I got a witness here? The Bible says that he'll prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. I leave you here this morning when I tell you that the same wall that stabs you in the back are the same walls that God is going to bless you in front of. The same wall that no bitches for you, and the same wall that's going to see your deliverance. The same wall that's scandalizing your name, or the same wall that's going to call your name. The same wall that says you never make it, or the same wall that's going to come visit you. The same wall that counted you out, and going to be standing there when the Lord counts you saved. Yeah.
Yeah.